Hey, what's up everybody, and welcome back to our tutorial series on Jenkins. In the last two videos, I showed you how to integrate GitHub with Jenkins, and I also walked you through the installation of the Maven integration plugin, which laid the groundwork for this video. So let's take a look at the next topic. In this video, we are going to create a Jenkins job for a Maven project. I'll quickly recap some of the key features of the Maven project job type. The Maven integration plugin provides a new job type in Jenkins called a Maven project. And the Maven integration plugin significantly reduces the manual configuration required to set up a Maven project in your Jenkins. Additionally, the plugin provides test reporting directly in the Jenkins interface. And with that, let's go ahead and get started. Okay, so the first thing that I wanted to do was quickly walk through the Maven project that we're going to build in our Jenkins server. And I have the Maven project pulled up in my GitHub account. It's called Sample Maven Project, and it's a very basic Java application. And I actually generated this code base automatically using the Maven Quick Start archetype. And if we take a look at the Quick Start archetype, it will generate a sample Maven project for us with a very simple structure. And if we take a look at the directory structure, it begins with a top-level pom.xml file. Then we have the source directory, and inside of the source directory, we have a single app class. And then we also have a test directory, which contains the app test class that tests this app class. So if we navigate back to the GitHub repository, we can take a look at the app class and see what it does. So if I navigate to the app class, it's very simple. It just prints out "Hello World" to the console. And then if we go back to the test directory and open up the app test class, this is also very simple. It's a single JUnit test. It's assert true with an always true condition. So it should always pass. So this is the code base that we want to build in our Jenkins instance. So let's navigate to Jenkins and we will create a new Maven project. So opening up Jenkins, and then I'm going to select the new item page, and I'm going to call it test Maven project. And then I'll select the Maven project job type, and I'm going to click OK. And the first thing that we want to do is set up our source code management. And so I'm going to scroll down to the SEM section, and then I'm going to select Git. And then we need the repository URL. And remember that this is going to be the SSH URL for the repository. So I'm going to navigate back to the GitHub repository, and I'm going to copy the SSH URL. And I'll paste that into the repository field. Okay, and I get a permission denied error, which means that I haven't selected the credentials to use to clone down this repository. So I'm going to select my SSH private key that was previously added. And you can see that the error disappears after selecting the private key, the SSH private key. The next thing that I'm going to update in this configuration is the branch specifier. I only have the main branch in this repository, so I'm going to just update that to main. And the next configuration that we're going to update is the build triggers. And you may remember me discussing this first build trigger, build whenever a snapshot dependency is built, when we were first installing the Maven integration plugin. But essentially, whenever this build trigger is checked, any snapshot dependency that is defined in this project's POM file is built on this Jenkins instance. So if any other dependencies defined in the POM file are built on this particular Jenkins instance, then those builds, those dependency builds, will trigger a build for this job that we're defining now. And although there aren't any dependencies being built on this Jenkins instance for this particular project, I am just going to leave it checked since it's checked by default. The next trigger worth noting is the build after other projects are built trigger. It's somewhat similar to the first build trigger, But when I have this trigger selected, it allows me to specify a list of jobs on this Jenkins instance. And when those jobs are built, it will trigger a build for the current job that we're defining. And there is a second condition that I can specify here to trigger only if the build in the project specified in this field are stable, or I can trigger it even if the build is unstable in these projects that I defined here, or I can trigger it even if the builds fail in the projects that I defined in this field. This trigger might be useful if you have multiple jobs and each job only performs like a single task, and it's like a pipeline of jobs that you want to run in succession. But in this case, we don't really need that. And even if you did have multiple jobs like that, that are kind of like a pipeline of jobs, it would be preferable to just write a pipeline script and have a single pipeline job to handle those individual tasks. So I'm going to go ahead and uncheck this build trigger. The next build trigger is build periodically. And this trigger allows you to schedule this job on a predefined cadence. And you can use cron style syntax in this field to specify how often this job will build. So for instance, if I wanted this job to build every minute, I would use this syntax. And you can see here it says, do you really mean every minute when you say, you know, five stars there? Perhaps you meant hourly. Okay, so this would be the syntax for running this job hourly. And I think this build trigger is particularly useful when you use it for your release cycle cadence. So for instance, you might want to have like a nightly build of your main branch, or you might have a weekly build of your main branch, or you might have a release at the end of every sprint. So maybe you want to schedule this for every 2 weeks or every 3 weeks. And I think that's where this build trigger is most useful. In this case, I'm not going to utilize this trigger, so I'm going to go ahead and uncheck it. The next trigger is the GitHub hook trigger for Git SEM polling. And this is the trigger that we set up in the previous video. So when this is checked, anytime a developer pushes a commit to GitHub or makes a commit directly in the GitHub interface, an event is sent to Jenkins that will trigger this job for the code base that they push that commit to. And I am going to utilize it for this Maven project, so I'm going to go ahead and check it. And the last build trigger is pull SEM, which is kind of the opposite of the GitHub hook trigger, because it allows you to schedule a predefined cadence for Jenkins to pull your source code management, whether it be GitHub or another source code management system, for new changes. I've mentioned this in previous videos, but using this build trigger is kind of a bad practice. You don't necessarily want to pull your SEM system. If you do, you want to do it infrequently, maybe like once a day. Probably once a day would be like the most frequent, maybe once an hour, but in general, polling the SEM system is bad because you're consuming resources on the SEM system, and you're also consuming resources on this Jenkins instance to query or make a query to the source code management system to check if there's any new changes. So it's really a best practice to always set up, if possible, the GitHub hook trigger if you're using GitHub, or if you're using another SEM system, use some sort of webhook that will push new changes to Jenkins rather than having Jenkins pull the SEM system. So I'm going to go ahead and uncheck this pull SEM option. Now remember, we do have to set up the webhook inside of the GitHub repo if we select this option. So after we save this new Maven project, we'll go ahead and add that webhook to our GitHub repository. The next configuration that we want to set up is the build configuration. And under the build section, we can specify where the root POM is located. And here we can leave this value as is, since the POM file is at the root directory of our Maven project. And on the second field here, we can specify goals, Maven goals, and options. So for instance, I can specify clean install in this field. And if I were to leave the field blank, it would perform an install by default. It would perform the install lifecycle. But I could also specify deploy here if I had a remote repository that I wanted to send the generated artifacts to. But I'm going to go ahead and leave this as clean install. So that should be the bare minimum configuration that we need for this Maven project. So I'll go ahead and select save. And before we build this project for the first time, I want to add the webhook to our GitHub repository. So I'm going to copy the address here. So we'll copy the port. And then in the GitHub repository, we'll navigate to settings. And in settings, we'll select webhooks, add webhook. And then the payload URL will be the URL of the Jenkins server and the GitHub webhook endpoint. Okay. And I'll select JSON. And we'll leave the default selection. So this will send the push event to Jenkins. And we'll leave it as active. I'll select add webhook. Okay. And if I select the webhook, we can see under recent deliveries that it was a successful delivery. So we know it's configured correctly. And now let's navigate back to our Jenkins instance. Now let's build the project for the first time. So I'm going to select build now. And let's take a look at build number one. So it performed the Maven clean. It compiled and then it ran the single test case and the app test class. And then it performed the install as well. So it archived the snapshot jar in the local repository. And what's neat, if we take a look back at the project page itself, after the build runs, we get this test result trend, which shows the duration of the tests on the y-axis and then the build number on the x-axis. So if I hover over this single data point here, we can see that build number one, one test passed and zero tests skipped and zero tests failed. And additionally, if I go into the build itself, we also get kind of a test report inside of Jenkins. So if I take a look at the test result, we can drill down into the module, the package, and then the test class itself, and then look at all of the tests within a single class and take a look at whether or not they passed or failed. And if the test failed, then we can also get the stack trace directly in this interface as well. So we could see, the stack trace and get a little bit more details on the failure. And from the build page, we can also access build artifacts. So as you can see here under build artifacts, I can download the snapshot jar or the snapshot palm locally to my machine. And this would be especially useful if you wanted to perform manual testing after automated testing occurs on the generated snapshot. And just for the sake of it, let's update our test case to fail just so that we can see what the test report looks like when a test case fails. So I'm going to navigate back to the GitHub repository and I'll navigate to our test directory. And this will also exercise our webhook as well, or it should if our webhook is working correctly. I'll open up the test class and I'll directly modify it in the GitHub interface. We'll change that condition to false. Okay, and then I will commit that change. So let's take a look back at our Maven project in Jenkins. And let's see if it successfully triggered a build. And it took a little while for the Jenkins interface to update, but it did trigger a build. And as you can see, for build number two, it is unstable. The yellow mark indicates that it's an unstable build. And unstable means that one or more test cases failed. And if we take a look at the test result trend, we can also see that build number two is represented in the graph. And in build number two, we have one failed test case. And I'll quickly open up the build number two page. And if I select the test results, you can see the number of failures is listed up here, that there was one failure. And then it lists the failed tests. And if I expand this out, I can expand the stack trace for this failed test. And it's a pretty simple one. All it says is that there is an assertion error because the condition that we selected was, or that we added to this test case was false. So that's all I have for this video. I hope you enjoyed it. And in the next video, I'm going to walk you through the process of setting up a Jenkins controller and Jenkins agent nodes. So I will see you in the next video. If you'd like to learn more, be sure to follow our blog at lambdatest.com/blog, as well as our Lambda Test community at community.lambdatest.com. You can also earn resume-worthy Lambda Test Selenium certifications at lambdatest.com/certifications.